The Senate Democrats are holding a press conference talking about Amy Coney Barrett and their issues with the nomination process for this most recent likely entrant to the Supreme Court. They're doing that, but it is looking like she is probably going to end up on the court. And that is important for a lot of reasons that we've talked about on the show for several weeks now. But I want to focus in on one of perhaps the most important, and that is what Amy Coney Barrett's presence on the Supreme Court means for Americans' reproductive freedoms going forward. And joining us now to break this down, lay out the stakes, and tell us how things might develop over time is Mary Ziegler, law professor at Florida State and author of Abortion and the Law in America. Mary, welcome to the Damage Report.
Thanks for having me.
Thank you very much. You're seeing the book cover right there. So one of the often mentioned fears around Amy Coney Barrett, what impact she could have on the Supreme Court, is that it could mean that Roe v. Wade is going to be overturned. I'm not a legal scholar. That's why we're bringing you on. Do you think that that's effectively going to happen? We're just wondering when. How inevitable do you consider that?
There's nothing inevitable when you're talking about the Supreme Court. These people are there for a lifetime, at least until something changes, which means that there can always be surprises. But it would be a pretty big surprise indeed if the Supreme Court didn't overturn Roe, because you have to remember, right, there's already a 5-justice conservative majority that's been put there with an eye to overturning Roe. And now there's an insurance policy in the form of Amy Coney Barrett. So for example, even if Chief Justice Roberts or one of the court's conservatives got cold feet about overturning Roe, it wouldn't matter anymore because there would still be 5 votes to overturn Roe. So I think we're more looking at a question of when, not if.
And you know, during the Senate hearings that went on, she attempted to portray herself, as many of those trying to get on the Supreme Court do, as a person who has no preferences, no thoughts, no ideology, nothing. It's just a case will come and I will take a look at it. I will read many dusty books and then I will decide. Based on what you have seen about Amy Coney Barrett and her history, do you think that that's an accurate reflection of what she'll be like on the Supreme Court?
I mean, that's not really an accurate reflection of what anyone is like on the Supreme Court, but I mean, certainly it's not an accident that President Trump promised to pick someone who would overturn Roe and then picked Amy Coney Barrett. He did that because she's that person. We know a little bit about her record. She hasn't been a judge for very long, but as a judge on the 7th Circuit Court of Appeals, she pretty much would have voted to uphold every abortion restriction that came before her. And in doing that, seemed pretty willing to either ignore or effectively rewrite judicial precedent to get the result she wanted, which obviously doesn't bode well for Roe and the cases that follow it, which of course are precedent too. Amy Coney Barrett in her private life is pro-life. Now that doesn't mean she'll necessarily vote that way, but I think President Trump and his allies expect her to, which is why her nomination has been so energizing on the right.
Now, obviously, we're talking about her. We're talking about the Supreme Court, but a lot of abortion law is, you know, it's made at the state level. So, right, to what extent is the? I don't want to just launch into this conversation without it first questioning the Supreme Court's obviously important. What percentage of this conversation is the Supreme Court? If you're a woman who's worried about what the future might bring in this area, how important is her presence on the Supreme Court for that?
It's really important because the way to think about it is that at the moment there's a federal constitutional abortion right, which sort of sets the floor. So states can do whatever they want as long as they don't fall below that floor. Amy Coney Barrett on the Supreme Court likely means that that floor is gone, right? Which would open the door to states passing outright bans on abortion, which they've already signaled that they're interested in doing. And the only reason those laws are not in effect right now is because the federal courts have blocked them, citing Roe. So a lot of the action is in the states, and it's worth saying that if Roe is gone, then what abortion access looks like for women, and maybe contraceptive access too, we can talk a little bit about that, will depend on state Supreme Courts and state legislatures. But there won't be that kind of safety net anymore that there is now in the form of a federal constitutional abortion right.
And you know, whether it's legislation that would be passed to outright ban abortion in the wake of Roe v. Wade being overturned, or you know, I've read about legislation that is effectively in a holding pattern until it's overturned. Do we have any idea of how many states would very significantly curtail these freedoms, if not outright ban them?
We know it's at least a minimum of 21. There are 21 states that have laws already that would essentially ban most or all abortions if Roe is overturned. A lot of those are called trigger laws, right? The idea being that if Roe is gone, the trigger is pulled and the law automatically goes into effect. It's not clear that that'll be where it stops, right? There may well be more than 21 states. You can kind of roughly think of putting states in three categories. You'd have very blue progressive states that would probably expand access to abortion. You'd have conservative red states that would ban probably all or most abortions, including in cases of rape or incest. And then you'd have states like Florida, where I am, that would become, as they always are, kind of battlegrounds where the outcome would be hard to predict ahead of time.
And I've seen polls. It seems consistently that most Americans support maintaining at least the current level of access to these sorts of services. The polls during the Amy Coney Barrett hearing seem to confirm that. So I know that you're not here mainly to talk about the political implications of this, but it seems like an odd move to outlaw something that the majority of people support in so many states simultaneously. I wonder, has that been a part of the conversation as these laws have been passed about the possible electoral ramifications of it?
Yeah, I mean, I think what's interesting is that there's lots of historical evidence that people in the GOP love the idea of using Roe to raise money and to rally the base, but they haven't historically really loved the reality of Roe being overturned, in part because it isn't popular, and also in part because then there's no whipping boy, right? You can't use Roe to fundraise or rally the base anymore. It's not the same calculus at the state level, because what may be disastrous politics nationally might be quite successful in Mississippi or Alabama or a place like that where you have fairly strong majorities of voters opposed to most abortion. But I think even there you're dealing with some potential political fallout. After all, Mississippi in 2011 had an option to pass a personhood law, right, that would have banned abortions and potentially also banned in vitro fertilization and contraception, and voters rejected it. Now, that was obviously not because voters support abortion rights, but it was because when the rubber met the road and they had to think about what an abortion ban could mean in practice, a lot of conservative voters blinked. And so I think it'll be a challenge in even the most conservative states for lawmakers to kind of flesh out what it's going to mean to ban abortion. So for example, are women going to be punished? Or do you include things like IUDs, which many pro-life or anti-abortion folks believe are abortifacients? Like, those are going to be really challenging to answer questions, even in states where it's been very good politics up until now to go after Roe.
Yeah, and when the rubber hits the road, the doctors being hauled into prison or the women being jailed, that's probably going to be quite difficult. It's very easy for Trump in an offhand comment with Chris Matthews to say that women should be punished, but what exactly is that punishment? Is it a fine? Is it prison terms? Do we want to be a country that does that? For more political news breakdowns, interviews, stories of activism, and me trying my hardest to care about the occasional big celebrity news story, subscribe to our YouTube channel at youtube.com/thedamagereport. And you can ring the bell wherever it is so you don't miss anything.